Britain has a rich and diverse landscape, ceaselessly changing with the seasons and the lives of its people. It has provided inspiration to artists for centuries. Painting the landscape is a familiar occupation. The artist carries his paints, brushes, and easel out into the countryside and faithfully renders the view he sees before him. But even when a painter sets out with just such an intention, the reality is more complex. Every painter brings their own unique vision to the canvas. The time in which they live, the political, social, and economic circumstances of the age, and their own personal situation will all manifest themselves in the final picture. Landscape painting is a discipline in which British artists are acknowledged to have created some of the greatest work made anywhere in the world. But it was not born here. We imported, borrowed, and learned how to paint the landscape. In the process, we recorded the history of our country and its people, the value placed on its land, and the aesthetic and cultural worth of our vision of ourselves. These labourers may have had other reasons to harbour dark thoughts of revolution. For some, the improvements in farming had come at a high price. Throughout the 18th century, the Enclosure Acts had changed the face of the British landscape. Ancient common lands, where grazing rights were shared, were enclosed, and absolute property rights were enforced by the landowners. The effect of these draconian changes were felt most keenly by the rural poor. A London painter called George Morland began to paint landscapes that told the stories of this new, dispossessed underclass, a rather less comfortable vision of society than that offered by Stubbs's happy labourers. Ferreting, the subject of this picture from 1792, was no simple country pastime. It could get you hung.
The mechanics of how people go ferreting, man, dog, ferret, working in harmony to catch these rabbits, is timeless. But there will always be people who have permission and people who don't have permission of having this little dog to tell me where the rabbits are. It makes my life a lot more easier. As I'm putting the nets down, you'll see she'll go around the warrens and she'll distinctively mark where the occupied warrens are. And that's the beauty of having a good lurcher as a ferreting dog. Back then, the ferret would have been not transported around in a box like today. There'd be little pockets sewn into the jackets so they could keep the ferret in there so they could walk through the town or the village and nobody knew what they're up to. People, when they come under hardships, have survived wars, recessions and strikes, eating rabbit. If they were quiet and they had a good dog, they could have filled the bucketfuls with rabbits. It wasn't just about the rabbits. Everything on this land belonged to the landowner, whether it be the berries, the mushrooms. It was a larder, and that was his larder. Even the twigs and the firewood, he owned everything. To him, taking a rabbit It's the same as taking the berries and the mushrooms, the same as taking his family silver. It was his, and he didn't want anybody to take it.